Six, five, four, three, two, one. Woo! PC Games. Welcome, everybody. This is Luxov Lux covering the PC gaming show.
Three, two, one.
Oh, woo! You can hear my countdown again because I forgot to mute my fucking stream.
Oh my god, they're putting the chip in. Oh yeah. There goes the RAM.
I'm live. Say hello, Howard. Canadian Bacon, to my
Hi.
Audience.
Oh, they're hooking up SLI mode. Crossfire.
Mark Lau moved in from root by the server.
Hey, Mr. Plow, welcome to the stream.
What's up?
Say hello to everybody.
Hello, everybody. So what do we get here?
This is the PC Gaming Show, first time ever at E3. As we should know, because Mr. Plow and I were reading E3 history last night at midnight.
Good job. Online.
Reading that again tonight.
But we've got to finish it. We only got to 2,000.
Yeah, that's true. There's a lot more to do.
There's much
kills
up to 2015, right?
Yeah. Although that site only goes to 2005, it was celebrating the 10 years of E3.
Was that a cat spewing fire?
Was. Yeah, what was the Mountain Dew bottle overflowing? Was that a sexual innuendo? Or?
It's just it's instead of champagne, it's Mountain Dew.
Because of the medium, right?
Yeah, we don't drink champagne.
For the context,
PC gamers.
That makes sense. It's Minecraft, I recognize that.
Wing Commander? LOL.
Prince of Persia, was that?
Oh, my
yeah,
super!
Here we go. Diablo 3.
But this is, this is exciting.
I'm pretty excited.
This is only going to happen once, and we're a part of it.
Well, StarCraft 2. It'll probably happen. What do you mean once? Like, the PC gaming show?
The inaugural PC gaming show.
Yeah, the inaugural one. Inaugural one will only happen once, you're right.
The inaugural one, yeah.
I can't speak.
I'm hoping for Heroes of the Storm new hero or two.
They are announcing stuff, I heard, for Heroes of the Storm.
I heard that as well.
Here? On this event?
I'm going to announce things, actually. Yeah.
Yeah.
We're going to play after.
I was taking a look at the RimWorld updates. Oh, here we go.
Quiet, everyone.
Ladies and gentlemen. Oh, RimWorld, yes.
Welcome to the PC Gaming Show! It's pretty exciting. It's got a number of very positive reviews out there. It is still
Hey, Pride Delta.
Yeah.
Alright. How is Fallout Shelter? Is it good?
That's Sean, Day 9 Plot.
Thank you so much for coming out today. Hello, everyone on the internet. Thank you for tuning in. As you can tell, I'm extremely excited to be here.
He's really
is an amazing platform.
I can tell he's excited because he's got a pee stain.
I like his pants.
I can't tell when he's excited because he always talks the same excited way.
Range of creative experiences, all realized on the PC. We invited a huge number of guests today, and none of them said no. So we have a packed schedule. Like, look at how many cue cards I have.
And there's a lot
of
cue cards.
Starting right now.
You should get a tablet.
So without any further ado, oh yeah, I like that. Woo! Right back at you.
But he's
without
old school, right?
Ado, let us
Who? This guy?
Yeah, he's got cue cards.
Floor two. Oh yeah, it's John very old school. I guess they didn't want to get somebody famous from outside the gaming world.
Good to see you, John. Welcome, John. Join me on this unusually large sofa.
I'll just lay down right here.
That's right. If you want to tell me about any of your problems, we're going to have to wait till after the show.
Okay.
Because I want to talk about Killing Floor 2. Of course,
Absolutely.
Killing Floor 1, very unique concept, very unique gameplay style. And now you're working
Did you guys play
sequel.
Killing Floor?
What does
it
mean to expand upon
no.
that original
I've,
gameplay?
I have played
so
it.
For us,
I played
one of the
it,
most
played
important
it.
You dabbled?
Killing Floor
dabbled.
1 had this really fun core gameplay.
Would you prefer
so
the host
really
to be
to
a
make
hot
sure
chick
to do
or
not screw
yeah,
that
day
up?
Nine.
I mean, that is so important. We in the past,
could
we've
could
done
we combine the two
kind
together?
Departed from that core gameplay in the fans. They weren't too happy about that. So
no, it's not me.
Don't screw that up.
Which, what's buffering? So, are you watching the...
I'll stop downloading. I'm watching the stream. I'm also downloading, solid.
You're not watching yourself?
Access, just keep I'm watching myself, yes.
On Jackstream. On top of that.
So you've been well, in early access as you know, Bacon can't going? Be doing less than
it's been going really well. I mean, the game's selling great.
It's true.
We're playing a game while watching
really interesting feedback.
Set an accent,
I think I played Dota 2.
It's also been
too bad,
a learning experience for us, too, though.
Because, I can imagine, yeah.
Because it's so casual.
One of the things that we discovered really early on was fans had this expectation that we
probably
were...
Probably Hot Chick, I guess,
you
right?
Know, it's early
I don't
access,
even know who this guy
so
is.
That means the full version is going to be done in 2 weeks, right? You know, it just came out, so it's going to be done.
I have it, so I'm going to have all of it all immediately,
it'll
right?
Be done
there's absolutely
right away.
No chance
but
Half-Life
in reality, you know, there's a lot
announced
of development to be done to finish the game.
Well, there's never a
so
chance,
what
but
really
eventually it'll
is,
happen, right?
It's so important to communicate with the players.
I'm serious.
You know, it's going to be a long time.
I don't think it's
going to
happen.
You know,
though.
That would be
like
very weird.
Regular updates where we're telling them, you know.
Although
it would have been like some
Last Guardian, you know,
with the Vive, progress, right? Like,
you know,
going
game,
on, that could be.
Bugs, you know, and you
I don't think
could be a thing.
Just push it out there. Has features.
You're actually playing Dota 2?
Of course. I want to take a look at some of those new features.
What are you just have this playing in the background?
What is he saying? Tell me what he's saying. Like you guys are listening.
I don't know.
We're broadcasting here. This is a professional show. You can't be playing Dota 2. Look at my graphics. I've got graphics.
Okay, here. I think you're right.
Yeah. Wait. What do you think of this game?
I'm just kidding. You can play Dota 2. I don't give a shit.
It looks great.
Now I'm not playing Dota 2.
I guess we can compare this to Doom.
This? No.
Yeah. This looks less generic, I suppose.
It's like gory, violent, ultra-violent.
Strictly multiplayer, I think. There might be a single that's very
it looks like a mix of Doom and Left 4 Dead.
It is like
yeah,
Left 4 Dead.
It is like Left 4 Dead, yeah.
Surviving waves. Well, it isn't. You're not going through a level, you're more like... Or at least
surviving.
Surviving
waves of
waves, yes.
Zombies.
You could weld monster. Doors shut and stuff like that. And
I've actually heard Killing Floor 1 is a lot of fun. Like, it's like one of those land games, right?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I mean, we should do that at our next land, then.
Yeah.
Or consider it.
Yeah, we should consider it.
I'm ready to consider this.
So Andrew, you can see that I'm not playing Dota 2 now, right?
Wait, let me check.
Are you hiding it?
What?
He's appearing offline. Fucking son of a bitch. Or he unfriended me.
He unfriended you, yeah.
You know, I've seen this video a few times now.
That looks good, actually. Like, I'm... That video got me more hype than the Doom footage.
Doom one looked like
pretty generic.
Doom was for its time. Was like, wow, this is new. Doing it again now is not. It's
we've gone further. We've gone.
Yeah, yeah.
We've gone past.
And
the canned animation.
Yeah,
it's like just better graphics.
Yeah.
And especially when they showed the same canned animation like 3 or 4 times in like a short span.
Stuff.
Yeah, but do the graphics look awesome?
They do.
Yeah, they do. But I wasn't like blown away.
Go play Brutal Doom and that's. You know, Doom is still there. Like it still doesn't look good, but... or it does look good, I guess you could say. I mean, I don't know.
It's like classic good, right? Like, it's...
Yeah.
It doesn't look ugly. It looks old, but it doesn't look ugly.
Yeah, I just saw the screens. I didn't see any videos for the new Doom game, but... It basically looked like they took Doom 2 and made it look... use, like, today's graphics.
Yeah. And then there's more three-dimensional, like... 90 seconds straight. The
little booty black cock.
Interesting.
For sure, man.
I mean, what else do we get a chance to see in this video?
So are you guys excited about the new Dota 2 engine and so on?
I am.
I'm super excited about that.
Yeah, so we really
that is much needed, for sure.
Is it actually, is there any graphical improvements, or is it just the custom games, the UI?
Well, they're changing the engine to the Source 2 engine, so I guess there might be some graphical improvements. Like, they're saying performance-wise it should improve, but I don't think they're changing, like, the textures or anything like that.
Because the video I saw the game looks the same graphics.
Yeah, does it look good?
So it's not going to look better. Firebug perk and the demolition perk,
as you saw, you know, there's a rocket launcher. Theramus, is there like going to be any graphical improvements to the game?
Really neat shotgun that shoots flames. So we're super excited about that. And really, you know, one of the things I didn't mention about early access, we really want to get across.
And welcome, sir.
Early on, you know, we're working on our stats for our game and everything, and we're telling people like we might have to reset your player progression. But one thing that
ooh, custom
we're
games.
Happy to announce,
ooh, hide and seek. That sounds cool, actually. You know, you've seen this blog post yet, Andrew?
Yeah, no, I took a look at that. The Overthrow video looks kind of it's like a free for all, and you stand near the.
Is it? Are they talking about some of the custom games that are going to come out for Dota 2? Yeah.
Well, I mean, I just there's a like a graphic of custom maps, like a real world graphic, not a game. But one of the little buttons there says hide and seek. Just made me think, wow, it'd be fun, a hide and seek game.
That is pretty exciting.
But we could do that in real life.
Yeah, true. They say they're kind of going back to their roots in order to promote more community content. And right here on the stage, right now, exciting. Let's
take a look. Oh. Never seen it before. This is a world exclusive, guys.
It's Andrew's stream. Somebody no one has ever seen.
What?
Sick bird.
bird.
I'll have you know, there's just two people watching now. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Drew Martin.
Neither one of them is Mr. Plow.
So this looks pretty good.
Vietnam.
Yeah, I remember this from my time in Nam.
Yeah, it brings back bad memories, actually. Battlefield Vietnam 2.
What a glorious time.
Well, it's gonna be a Vietnam, whatever strike that game.
How's the sound, guys? Like, can you hear Mr. Plow and Canadian Bacon well? Is the video sound too loud?
Those explosions are subpar.
Worst explosions I've ever seen.
Oh, Rising Storm 2.
Sounds good. Cheers. Excellent.
Golf clap.
You may have heard there would be reveals, and we have delivered on that
Looks
promise
good.
Within the first 10 minutes of the show. So far, so good. Now, our next guest, whom we invited, was unable to make it today.
What do you think of the format of this show?
Recording for us. It's he a bit, works on a game called it's slightly less, what you call it,
Who's the Woo guy in the
this
back?
This farts things I just had, anyway. First Woo.
Nice work.
Thanks for sharing that.
$4 million coming in every time I see a new clip.
That's
I
for the view.
Okay, good.
It's for yeah.
Let's say hi to the digital form of the CEO of Cloud Imperium Gaming.
Yeah, I'm glad YouTube Gaming is adding Smell-O-Vision as well.
Yeah,
I think.
Yeah.
I could add quite a bit. Welcome to Ealing. This should be interesting. In London,
England. The format, it's cool, but
it feels a bit forced, actually.
Los Angeles for it's a RSI.
PC gaming press conference. I wish I could be with you guys. I'm so happy that we're actually having a dedicated press conference for PC games, and they're getting the appreciation and attention that they should at E3 and other gaming conventions. And I'm having a lot of fun here in London, England, and we're doing amazing things with both Star Citizen and Squadron 42. We're really trying to push storytelling and the fidelity of performance capture, motion capture, how you relate to characters in a game, and that's only possible on PCs with the power of the platform, with what we can do.
Power the platform.
Facial animation and what we can
that
do.
That face looks pretty animation, what crazy. We can do in terms of
these are realistic looking faces, visceral, I have to be honest.
Detailed world.
That was the motion capture thing.
I wouldn't be here doing it without everyone out there. That
look
are
how realistic his face
gamers.
Looks.
Oh my
building
god.
Literally a game that has a budget rivaling any of the big studio publisher games out there. And that's done entirely from a grassroots level at the PC gamer level, which is amazing.
How much did these guys raise?
Big corporation. It's not
they keep raising.
Like hundreds of millions?
By all you out there. And that just
like up to like 200 million yet or anything? PC
I actually don't know.
They're over 100, right?
Something, I don't know actually. I think it's more like a 50 or 60 million, which is a lot for a game.
No, I thought it was more.
I will be at the PC Gaming Conference.
I'm playing Dark Seas, and there's it's four melee and one necro.
Welcome, Pocket Clint.
So,
I like the way you put that. Star Citizen is relevant to my interests.
As we develop yes. it.
Yeah, it's I'm interested in that too.
That's great news, Seabass.
Like I said, I get rehyped every single time. And as we have so many developers
Rehyped.
Here with us today, we too have technologists to talk about what it's like to develop the things on which games are built. So please join me in welcoming.
So they announced the new AMD graphics cards, right? Oh, yeah, okay. Like, here we go. We're gonna get more of it now.
What are we getting here?
I was looking forward to this.
Absolutely. We got a briefcase. We got graphics.
This is relevant to my interests.
Everything one could possibly want in the world.
Please join me once again.
2022.
Right away. What on earth a chief gaming scientist?
Yeah, it's true.
Chief gaming scientist. Apart from being a complete mystery to me, and to most people, it's a communications role within AMD.
Right.
I talk to games developers. I ask them what it is that they're trying to develop. Ask them why they're trying to do it. Where they want to be in 2, 3, 5 years' time, maybe even further out than that. And I talk to them about the kind of stuff that we're building, why we're building the GPUs the way we're doing it. It's all a private NDA discussion, and I get shot if I talk about it in too much detail.
Except here.
Except
you're allowed
here.
To talk about it here. I
just between you,
here.
And I.
Okay,
keep it
cool. And some of our friends.
Keep it secret. There's an audience out there. Yeah. You're trying to trick me. I know.
That's why we have the bright lights. It's to confuse you and blind you.
And confused I am, as is usually the case. But the second role is actually a much more public communications role, where I talk about some of the cool stuff that we do, why we do it, and how to understand it in the context of an evolving industry.
Well, one of the first things I want to ask is, for a long time, it was all about increasing the number of polygons.
It's over 81 there, million, apparently.
After a while, there's only so
okay.
much
I thought
more
it was more
than that
can
do. And given that there's so many
you were almost wrong. Almost right.
Nowadays that they want to have, how do you, how does AMD approach it?
Well, it gets you a long way. When you start with Lara Croft having 300 or 400 polygons and you get excited about that.
Star Citizen, relevant to my interests as he boots up.
But there is a lot more to
Elite Dangerous.
So just this morning we introduced a new range of
weapons. That's funny. About that.
Pretty pleased to be able
it's good.
To do
well
that.
Done, Pocket Clint.
The Radeon R7-300 and the Radeon R9-300 graphics cards. These have some pretty cool, oh, there we are. Look, we've got a graphics card or two on the screen. These have some
that's
pretty
not
cool
real. That's
for
CG
gamers,
graphics card.
Where you can really up the
this
quality
is,
of the game.
This is an electronic launch.
On a pretty reasonable budget, the kind of $110-140 card. Right up to high-end gaming, where we're serious about a full-on gaming experience, and where we deliver, for example, a great smooth experience through FreeSync, where there's no tearing, no stuttering in the monitor. Everything's
G-Sync versus FreeSync.
Someone who works in, Web TV.
Canadian Bacon, you need to comment on that. What's the difference?
And I mean, also, VR is another huge problem that
it's a really big deal for us, yeah.
Canadian Bacon?
How do you tackle that, especially given the fact that it's not quite clear where VR
can you guys hear me?
Into the ecosystem yet.
Yes.
VR's
I don't know the difference between G-Sync and FreeSync.
It breaks down into two separate
different letters there.
A problem, I think, that need to be addressed. Yeah. One is
but they both have sync in them. I can tell you that.
Yeah.
You can deliver a
basically the
VR
same thing.
Oh, the 360s for me. That's mine.
Aspiration. Yeah, we're not into
it's very sleek aerodynamic.
If you want a great VR experience, you want something which is Oculus, for example, are looking for a 90th of a second as the maximum length of time between moving and getting the response back. Well, that needs a pretty powerful graphics card to do anything
right.
realistic in that time. And it also needs the other side of it. Is a really tuned software stack.
This guy's from French, right?
Hardware pipeline that can take
Francais? Yeah, he's not speaking English.
Deliver output really, really extraordinarily quickly.
Russian or French, probably.
I can't tell.
Gamers would never worry about a 90.
Can't understand anything he's saying though.
I freak out if I'm not 144 hertz, man.
Absolutely.
Real pro gamer here, man. So, in terms of what's coupled with the hardware, the software, DirectX 12, you've mentioned before the show that it serves a critical role in this entire pipeline.
We are big.
I'm
big
a big
fans
fan of DX12.
Yeah, it's a wonderful transition for the industry.
DX 12.
Looking forward to Windows 10 coming.
DX12.
Along.
As it's called in the industry.
DX 12 is going to do what
okay,
AMD
so you think of the Sony conference.
To be able to do with the hardware.
It was jam packed with stuff, Like wow,
the Guardian.
It's not about always shipping.
Yeah, that's pretty crazy.
Yeah. Trick you into paying for it. Actually,
it's happening.
What we really like you to do is to get the maximum value out of it. Because
I'll believe it when it's released.
As a customer who knows that we've tried hard for you if we do that. DX12 really rocks when it comes
I actually liked the Square Enix press conference.
With oh, yeah, Kingdom Hearts 3.
Hitman?
Well, the thing I like about it is it's like, it's really East and West, like combined together in one company. Like, you've got Just Cause and Hitman, and then you've got, like, Kingdom Hearts and Final Fantasy.
Are you excited about the remake?
Not really.
Hitman?
the throughput. Final Fantasy VII.
Not at all.
Yeah, it's like, unless they totally redo the gameplay, it's not really
interesting. Kind of antiquated.
Well, what Andrew Wallace was saying is that the story might not be as good as you think it is.
As you remember it.
Yeah, because you're so much younger when you were playing it.
Yeah. But Kingdom Hearts 3, I mean, that's been... And actually, this a long time coming. Two
CPU cores. I was saying they should do a Hitman Kingdom Hearts crossover so I can assassinate all the Disney characters.
Well, tell me a little bit about the goodies you've brought. I mean, I see got like a tangled setting a little bit. Metal,
you know, there was also I'm going to give you the they're bringing back an older franchise. I can't remember the name off the top of my head, but it looked like a Dark Souls-ish style game that interested me. Hold on, let me look that up.
Look it up. With one of your later guests, Lisa. Luckless, do you know anything about Lovelax? Do you know anything about RimWorld? Have you followed that? I've tried that
kind of thing. I do not know anything about it, no.
That's a friend of...
Oh, right, yeah. Okay, yeah. Can you make
brother of high school friend.
Are you plugging it?
You tease. Well, now that we've got all these viewers, it's pretty exciting. I think a lot of people are excited about it. He's been working on it for 2 years, sold 82,000 copies.
Sorry, how do we know him again? He's a friend of a friend?
Bacon and I went to high school with the guy that we're friends with, and it's his younger brother.
Oh, okay.
That started it up. $300-ish of hardware. And this he worked on BioShock more full-on. Infinite. This one from Asus.
Oh, nice. What did he do for that game?
Level designer.
Game designer.
I trust you play really? Games on a background was level. He's level design. Of
course. Yeah, he started out doing level design or like map design for Unreal, but then he was a game designer.
Nier is the game. Probably giving me a 6.5. And IER.
Here's what they're giving you.
That one intrigues me.
Thank you so much for coming out, talking a little bit about the technology today. Richard Huddy.
Always fun to chat with you.
And I won a case.
John, look after that for me, yeah?
Thank you so much.
So if you had a chance to look at the specs and stuff for the AMD cards, like are you...
Not a sign that I don't trust you, okay?
How do you think they stack up to the new GeForce cards?
Absolutely.
Thank you. I think... Well, we're saying like they're just like really cranking up the megahertz and they're going to run hot, whatever that's worth.
Okay.
But just so they could hit the same speed as the 980 Ti or whatever.
Okay.
Is the NVIDIA tech better or no?
The memory is apparently better. They're using some new kind of memory that.
And Jonathan on AMD or?
AMD, yeah. It's like a high density
memory foam or something. Yeah.
That's exciting.
Spray foam.
Now, despite memory. The fact that I've shamed myself by referring to it as a six-core monitor, I assure you I am a true PC gamer, and I want to know what it is like working on the Deus Ex.
Have either of you guys started watching Silicon Valley yet? It's quite fun.
No, I will.
I'll get there.
Get on it.
This format's kind of boring, I'm not going to lie.
It sounds too much like ads, even though the other stuff is ads too. But
just like
they're trying to make it personal too. But it is just coming off as like ads.
So what games you have coming up? Presented as wow, I'm presenting this game. It's like the same thing, but
exactly.
Like more showmanship.
Sorry, I interrupted you, Martin. What were you saying? I mean, Mr. Plow.
I think you were saying I'm gay.
Okay, good. Just wanted to confirm that.
Yeah, the '80s call. They want their bad jokes back.
Shots fired to the 80s.
I don't know, maybe just all video or something. Or just have people coming out and like announcing it. Like the whole Q&A.
So, I mean, how has the world changed since?
Kind of boring.
Well, we're 2 years after Human Revolution, and the last game was all a golden age for augmented people with cybernetic abilities and whatnot. And now, 2 years later,
Nintendo announced 14 titles. Did anybody watch that?
A lot of things.
Yeah, it was so bad.
Really?
I had no idea what I was watching.
God.
It wasn't a press conference. It was like, what do they call it? A digital
live stream, kind of
digital event or something like that.
Yeah.
It started out with like Muppet versions of like the president, yeah, of the top three guys in the company. Adam Jensen is back now. He's not working. And it was just weird, and the games just don't interest me at all.
I think some people are pissed with the Metroid stuff.
Agency and his goal is to stop the chaos over there.
But and there was like, it seemed like there was a lot of 3DS stuff. And those games, they all look like anime versions of The Sims to me. Like, I just didn't know what I was watching at the time, to be honest.
Oh, God. Bigger and more is not always better. So let's take a look. So there's nothing you were excited about?
No, nothing. How you are using that technology to I was trying, like, I was struggling to think about something that got me excited, and I couldn't think of anything. Star Fox? I don't know. I'm not.
They kind of blew their load, like Smash Bros, Mario Kart, and Super Mario. Like, they've done that.
Well, they've got Zelda still to do, right?
Yeah, it's true.
And so they've done Star Fox now.
I don't know, I was never that excited about Star Fox.
Yeah.
They should redo, like, Contra or something, although it's never them. The game is about
details, it's about, like, well, it's Konami, right?
Visual layering, and now with the Dawn engine. And DirectX 12, we can.
This game looks really, like, it looks really, well, beautiful. I wouldn't say beautiful, but, like, the fidelity of the world is quite high, like, very detailed, high res. Pretty amazing how stacked it is.
In terms of the actual. In terms of the actual environment with all these interactable.
Wow, that does look pretty ridiculous.
I mean. I assume it can just
but it still has that kind of surreal look to it, like it's a sci-fi, which is cool.
Yeah, it has like the Blade Runner-ish look.
Yeah.
Without all the fog. It all comes down to having a different department that they use to hide how bad the sets looked. What's going to be interactive, what's going to be not interactive in a specific. It's kind of funny that they're now able to make a virtual world that looks better than what they could make in a film set.
We're pretty good. Like, we trained on Human Revolution. Wow. I'm looking at the list of games announced by Nintendo.
We've talked about the development side, but
yeah,
they do not look good.
How do you tend to play through the game?
Poor Nintendo.
Because there's always so many.
Well, I was also saying that I haven't owned a Nintendo console since the Nintendo 64, and I even traded that in for a PlayStation at some point. Because I just the games just don't like I don't know, they're not adult themed enough for me, I guess.
Yeah. Well, I don't know.
They're fun, but like. Yeah, but like I could always go to a buddy's place and play that or something like that, right?
Yeah, that's true.
But it's not something I'd play on my own.
This last night, I think Nintendo does the whole local multiplayer really well.
For sure.
And for the PlayStation or the Xbox, I'd rather just play the games on the computer. To the extent they're available.
Yeah, I agree.
And you get two rounds of playtesting.
Which is also why I haven't owned a console for a bit, aside from the 360. Since I got a decent PC, I don't like. Aside, actually, the PS4 is kind of like it's interesting, maybe because of all the exclusive titles they have now.
Xbox One has backwards compatibility.
As what?
Backwards.
Yeah,
on the hardware, right? Not.
Balance all the different ways that people are going to play through the game.
It's always. And like Jen was saying, Tomb Raider, I think, is coming out first on Xbox. Team,
and it's always about understanding what we're trying to achieve. We know that from the get-go, we have four gameplay pillars: stealth, combat, hacking, and social. So as we build the adventure, as we build the missions, all the challenges, we have to keep in mind.
You say that social is one of the pillars of the gameplay?
Yeah. So we do a lot of map.
I guess he means like dialogue.
And when we play it, also like.
Not like social, like.
We're looking at what the.
Interacting with other players.
And sometimes we're, okay, it's cool, like, if you're the stealthy player, but what about the combat player? Mm. And now, what's missing and everything?
So these guys are British, right?
That allows us to really improve
the really strong British accents.
Australian or British,
or Irish.
And yet Irish could be Canadian. Things that we never thought could be Canadian. Possible.
They actually are Canadian.
South African. Yeah, Eidos.
Gentlemen, thank you so much for coming out to talk about Deus Ex. The footage looked beautiful.
Thank you.
And I can't wait to get my hands on it.
Right. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you, guys.
Eidos Montreal.
They need a band. Where's the band? Paul Schaefer.
That was close. Hey, that's I'm an engineer. Thanks so much. Yes.
Was that Human Revolution or whatever?
Deus Ex, known for being a long-standing
welcome to
PC
the
franchise.
What was it? The discussion. Another
long-standing franchise. I'm discussing, see?
With its upcoming installment. Hold on. Not easy.
I like the woo guy over here. The Half-Life 3 guy needs to just hold it.
I do like the crowd interaction, though. There's like, there was almost none of that in the other press conferences.
We have a video to talk a little bit about the history of Total War.
Ooh. They're really branching out with this series. I don't know if you've been following it at all, but I'm a big fan of Total War.
You are?
Yeah. I didn't play the last few iterations because, for those of you that have watched a few of these broadcasts, I tend to skip.
Sega, CA.
I tend to skip some like iterations of games because I just get tired of the gameplay. So I haven't played the last few, but I'll get back into this series for sure.
Total War.
Yeah.
How's your techies game going?
Pretty good. Or they have four melee. Is it?
Yeah.
That guy just throw the spear like 5 feet.
It's called a Pelham.
He was standing right next to the guy, basically. It's just not very cinematic when he throws it like 2 feet in front of him.
That's more like TV. Cinematic's like 5 feet.
Is this an RTS or?
It's like a grand strategy game as well. So it's like Civilization mixed with like large grand scale real-time strategy battles.
Yeah.
But the Civilization part isn't that deep.
More of a strategy game than a tactical.
Yeah.
Tactics are just like the StarCraft part. Really behind here, I gotta start.
But the battles look absolutely gorgeous. Like the units are always well animated and coordinated and stuff like that. And I think they're doing a Warhammer one, which sounds,
yeah, they are.
Sounds like a lot of fun.
How about Space Marine, the Warhammer? Third-person shooter.
Yeah, the Total War Warhammer.
About the upcoming Total War Warhammer, we have Andy Hall.
I might get this one because I like the idea of having like fantasy gentlemen, elements in this game. Because it was always like more historical.
The game isn't called Total Warhammer.
Well, we've got two fantastic brands there, and they both deserve equal billing, really. But you know, if you guys want to call it Total War Hammer, then the Chaos Gods aren't going to strike you down.
We have permission. Yes. One victory has been achieved thus far. You know, I immediately want to ask about, in the videos, and for anyone who's played the Total War franchise, it's so much rooted in history.
Maybe he needs a sidekick?
Now you have this fantasy setting with magic and different
Maybe
races.
That would make it more entertaining?
How does that
Maybe.
Allow you to
yeah, I don't know.
Play, to create new experiences?
Well, it's brilliant. I mean, for years...
Could have gotten Tom Green to be a sidekick.
...game, and the opportunity to do this with Games Workshop was just something we had to take. It's just such a rich world of full of giant creatures, flying creatures, as you say, magic.
Giant heroes flying creatures.
Larger than life and can kill 100 men on a battlefield. And it just enables us to play with that different sort of set of features in a Total War context and do things we've never done before and things that you've never seen in a game before.
Yeah, because I immediately heard you brought up the idea of heroes, which is, you know, sort of a core part to Warhammer. Tell me a little bit more about that.
Yeah, we... go on.
Well, I was going to say, you've got your lords and your heroes pretty much like in the tabletop game. Mm-hmm. And your lords, they're going to be your army generals, and you're going to have famous people, well, not all people, famous generals like Karl Franz and Gringor Ironhide. And then
those
heroes,
guys,
which are probably going to be a bit like the agents in Total War. So things like witch priests, witch hunters even. And warrior priests, and shamans and wizards, of course.
And there's a new feature as well, where when you use these heroes on the campaign game, if you embed them in an army and then fight a battle, they'll be there in the battle fighting, you know, alongside your other troops. And massively deep skills trees, so deeper than we've ever been, so you can really get into the character and the narrative of these heroes. And that's something that, you know, we've never pushed this far in a Total War series before.
And it's pretty incredible to see some of the figurines that I recognize. And I mean, these are now in the game and animated, right?
Yep. Yeah. I mean, for me as a lifelong Warhammer fan, Karl Franz, for instance, it's a miniature I own, it's a miniature I've painted. To see him then animated and talking and rousing his men It's a Warhammer fan's dream. I think this is the Warhammer game everyone's been waiting for.
I'm very excited to see the way that you marry the epic scale of Total War with the miniature feel of Warhammer. Guys, thanks so much for coming out to talk.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Cheers. Woo!
Yes.
Now, where could they possibly go from there?
We've just gotten a chance to talk to the people working on Deus Ex and Total War. And these are, of course, some names that I'm sure no one is surprised.
Are you winning your game?
Mm-hmm.
I think we're winning, but it's not really doing anything.
Very surprised to see on the dock and very excited to hear what he has in store. The head of Xbox from Microsoft, Phil Spencer.
Whoa, hold on a second.
Yes.
Phil Spencer.
This is a PC gaming show. Why is the Xbox guy there?
Welcome.
Nice to meet you.
Welcome to the
Windows
PC
10.
Gaming
That's
show.
Right.
Oh my god. It bought their way in.
Phil. Welcome to the PC gaming show. We talk about PCs. So Phil, I would be thrilled for you to tell me a little bit about what Microsoft is here for.
Yeah, you know this. Well, first, I just want to say I think it's great that there's a PC gaming conference press event here at E3. I think that's fantastic.
Thanks.
Is anyone against having a PC gaming conference?
When we had the opportunity to get involved with this and help put it on, it was a great opportunity, and I definitely wanted to jump at it. And I wanted to have the opportunity to come on stage because it's. There have been times in our past where Microsoft maybe has lost our way with PC gaming. And as the person now who runs gaming for Microsoft, Windows and what people have done on PC is critical to both our success and critical to Windows' success. So getting the opportunity to come here and talk directly with fans and the press and be in the event was something I look forward to. So it's great to be here.
Yeah, I'm so glad to have you. I mean, tell us a little bit about your plans for the PC.
Yeah, you know, we have Windows 10 obviously coming out in July. One of the early moves was to make the free upgrade for people. Really, we thought about that from a developer standpoint, that as developers look
Did you guys
at
sign up for the...
with everybody on as much as
no,
we
I have
one version
thing?
Of Windows, it just makes it easier.
To be like notified,
so
like pre-order your free copy
the first year, so that people
Windows 10.
Our test matrix just gets easier. That
would I'm very happy with Windows 7. I'm not sure that
and make it common across.
You're not going to make the upgrade,
so that if you're working on
well,
DirectX 12,
I mean, if they're going to remove
Live,
the
so
free upgrade, I
Xbox
might.
Live, the same IP,
but I'll hold
API
off as long
set,
as possible.
Service, just trying to make it easier for developers as they're developing Windows games.
So, is the goal to have a wide variety of cross-platform titles, both on the Xbox One and on the PC?
You know, for me, games,
how are you going to get DirectX 12?
I think
though?
There are a lot of opportunities for cross-platform, but I also think there are games that exist on a television, and there's games that exist PC and.
Are you playing fucking Heroes of the Storm or something, Martin?
It's no, not our job to dictate I'm listening to what they're
the
saying.
Kind of games that developers want to build,
what?
But giving developers the options,
what?
The opportunity.
That's not what we're supposed to be doing here. We're supposed to be talking over them.
Listen to Luck
constantly.
What I've seen in my time in the gaming space is
looking loveless.
Do you know how the basketball game's going?
That's why I think we're all here.
Well,
no, I have no idea.
Some of the upcoming games that we
is a basketball
are
game on?
Excited about.
Yeah,
it's
you know, there's been
game.
A lot of push I for us to do more in the first party.
It's hard to understand
will.
This
We're
guy when
well,
speaking in Swahili.
Also, I don't like to make promises or announce things before we have a plan. So
it's Golden State is destroying
one of the franchises
Cleveland right
that a lot
now.
Of people
end of the
have
first.
Asked me about
28-15.
Is Killer Instinct.
You know,
and,
press conference is entertaining. When?
When?
And we're going to allow people to play on PC.
I'm thinking about going to some of these World Cup women's
I think
soccer
it's a great
games.
Franchise for us.
My parents went to
very well. And
went to
it's,
one.
It's the beginning
oh, yeah.
yesterday.
There's some games Saturday.
I can make some grandiose promises.
I think
it'll
be a lot
I'm just
of
not
fun.
That kind of person. As our portfolio builds out on Windows, you'll hear more and more from us about what we have, what we're building.
And I also am so excited.
You're not constantly talking over them. I know.
Talk about the titles that they are
well, I've got a different set of people here.
I'm so excited about these two in particular. Please.
There's not so much negativity.
David Eckelberry and James Finney from Fable Legends and Gigantic.
Well, to be honest with you, this press conference actually is kind of the most interesting one to me. So I am paying attention a bit more to what they're announcing.
You are not allowed to begin speaking without a formal handshake. Yes. All right, now that that's out of the way. David,
yep.
I just saw the footage. Mm-hmm. We're just going to go straight into it right now. This is footage from Fable Legends. It's beautiful. I want to know about it. Tell me about what we're seeing.
So this is a premiere video that we brought for you today. What we're looking at is the diverse set of environments that we're going to just show off, right? The great thing about Fable Legends, it's this game that you can play on your Xbox One. It's a game you can play on a Windows 10 PC. And what we're really getting to build right now as we prepare to release the game later this year is an incredibly cool story-based world that you can spend time in with lots of different heroes, cool characters, more than two dozen different creatures to fight
Nintendo
against.
Is better.
And all of those options will be there regardless
that,
of platform.
That you thing was horrible. I don't think that's better than anything I've seen so far.
And I immediately want to ask about the way that you are able to use the, you know, DirectX Plus technology.
And what do you think of this, Andrew?
How more isn't necessarily Luckless. Better. How do you use that computing power to realize this vision?
Basically, what it gives us the power to do is to put...
I never played the Fable games, so I can't really say.
Fundamentally, you know, Fable Legends is about...
But I feel like there's just so much hype for these games every time, but, you know, they're going to be so open and...
You know, a level of graphics
interesting, and then they don't do that.
That our fans that, yeah, well, that's deliver, definitely something that, you know, cutting edge Fable is right famous for because
now,
of
over-delivering, over-promising, rather.
Peter Molyneux.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's always some of that dangerous stigma that people have associated with that. Walk me through the choice around the business model.
I think, you know, we thought about the new kind of game that we were building in Fable Legends.
What's the business model?
And we really wanted the opportunity for everyone to play it and make their own decision on it. Mm-hmm. It's a different kind of game. It's not exactly like Fable 1, 2, and 3. It has the opportunity for multiplayer, has this new villain that can play and play oppositionally. And I think that meant for us that the only way for our fans to find out
when is Heroes coming on? Do we know this?
Was simply to play
it's
it.
Next. Up next.
When we talked about it a lot.
Oh, did they say that?
Wanted to put it in
no,
the
I'm just guessing.
And you're just.
And how does this
well, think
of next.
Alphabetical order, right? F and then.
We're going to plan for years of content. We're
then
continue to make
H?
New characters, new quests.
Is there a G game?
Like that. And there had to be some way that we could deliver that to the user.
Maybe
you know,
new Gauntlet?
It could just be a $60 box or. You know, subscriptions are a kind of unused model.
It was horrible,
so,
just
when
like
we
this.
Talk about it. It just seemed to be the best way to do that is to continue to deliver great quest content and keep putting out new creatures and heroes for the.
Is there a schedule for this?
And I mean, I cannot disagree with the beauty that we saw there, but of course,
it shows the participants
on the PC, so I get to play it oh so easily.
Yeah, and it's great. It's really easy to play on the PC.
Yeah.
You can plug in a controller. You can use mouse and keyboard. You can do whatever you want.
Well, awesome. And of course, James, I've been.
Can I control it with my mind?
For quite a while. Let's take a look at some of the footage.
You said you could do whatever you want.
And, you know, for some people who are unfamiliar with Gigantic, it has a pretty unusual core gameplay to it.
Yeah,
it's not triple kill, guys.
As the name implies,
no,
it's
you didn't.
Around these gigantic
but yes, I did.
It's 5-on-5 PvP, played on Windows.
StarCraft 2 and
Xbox
Heroes are going to be on.
And each team consists of 5 unique heroes, but they also.
StarCraft 2 is going to be on the.
AI controlled.
Yeah, Legacy of the Void news.
Game. So. You've got your guardian, the enemy team has theirs.
I wouldn't mind playing that beta.
And, whichever
is this
guardian,
a. Let's start.
Their team,
are you in the beta? Do you know?
And I know that
I don't think I am.
Elements to the
I'll double
gameplay
check.
Is that it's a mix
yeah, you better
of
check.
A shooter and a MOBA. How yeah.
Okay, so this is another shooter MOBA title.
It's actually been
how do you
pretty,
check
fluid.
To see if
it's
you're
really
in?
Fun for us from a developer.
I'm
going to
log on to the.
So, you know, as we look at these different heroes, what we've tried to
the,
do
web one.
Is just, you know, we started with the basis of shooter controls, and we wanted to draw on MOBAs and strategy games and look at ways to make it a really compelling strategic back and forth. But each one of these heroes gives us a chance to create a character that works for people who have different skill sets.
The graphics of this game look really neat,
like
actually. Are you guys watching
guys
this?
Really
or are you doing other things,
though?
Oh,
baseball. That looks okay.
Some of them use more.
That's cool.
Well, I'm not so sure that the game is going to be fun, but it definitely looks
you
really
know,
nice.
A lot of MOBAs,
I'll stop making promises
looks
that
like
it's
statistical based. You know, your DPS, your tank, it's defined by those numbers. But in a shooter, so much of what seems like would...
Is that pixel shading? Is that what that is?
Would be...
Cell shading?
Player's ability to balance those two.
You know, we assume that you're good at character, depending on what the character calls for.
You're a game developer, right, Mr. Plum?
Yeah.
Graphics programmer?
As much aiming skill.
Yeah, he
some
plays
of them
the
are
game.
Much more about tactical
thinking,
no,
personal saying.
Thinking. So there's a character, Griselma, that
Motiga.
Summons these portal creatures.
If they
she's
made,
not really doing
what
the combat
made?
Herself, but she's got to think strategically about how she places things. Some of the characters, melee characters.
Cell-shaded, yeah.
You know,
I do not have Legacy of the Void.
It looks really good, actually.
And I mean, I know that there's a lot of very unusual hero design in the game. What are some of the ones that you're particularly excited about?
Oh man, all of them are a lot of fun. You know, I think
you
we
don't
had,
get to say that answer.
Yeah,
you have to get some really cool ones. Yeah.
All right.
Yes.
We've actually had a lot of fun on the team just letting people sort of put their creative vision into things. So, you know,
bit of a minor gripe with this press conference also is they should have the game on the name of the game on the big monitor above their heads as opposed to just the PC gaming show graphic.
Hurt enemies and
yeah,
and
I agree.
The characters during the course
yeah,
of the
or even just like at the bottom of the screen, or I guess they show the guy's name and the company, but
skill that can make the character play in very different ways. So you can build the Vadasi to be sort of the ultimate.
Because I've already forgotten what the name of the game is.
Real damage to.
Well, like I said, I've been following development of your games for quite some time. Very excited to see the full product soon. I understand, according to the screen,
according
the beta
to the screen.
Is in August.
Yeah, we're moving along.
I think we're going to win this
beta.
Win this game in the record time.
We're going to try to let it.
I think he's a record time game.
And then look for open beta later this year.
Well, gentlemen, thank you so much for coming out once again.
Thank you.
All right. This Heroes. Dustin Browder, come on.
Good job.
Oh my.
No, the Xbox guy's still on there.
One more guest.
We do.
Quite a surprise. Very excited to bring out the studio head of the Coalition, Rod Ferguson.
That's not what I expected.
No, it's the Coalition of Heroes of the Storm players.
Yes, welcome. No, it's Phil, I guess, just gets to oversee everything from the far chair. Hey, Phil. Hi. Yeah, if
Rod
you want to
needs
sit,
his space. He needs his space.
So, Rod, I'm going to leave this relatively open-ended. Tell us what brings you to the PC Gaming Show.
I may be announcing that Gears of War Ultimate Edition is coming to PC.
Oh.
But I'm not.
Let's go ahead and take a look at the Gears of War Ultimate Edition video to talk a little bit about what we're
doing. That's pretty cool, actually.
Well, I mean, Gears of War is basically the first
what, the Gears of War is coming to PC?
Not that I like that series anyway.
And on the console, it's 1080p, but
kinda like Halo coming to PC a little bit.
4K resolution support, like, unlimited refresh rate, DX12. You know, we're
going to support
the keyboard, we're going to support the wireless controller and the new Elite wireless controller.
I don't know, do you see it doing that well on the PC platform?
Visual meat there for the PC
platform. I think it's like Kanye Bacon said, it's people that haven't played it yet that have a PC.
2006.
Could pick, yeah, I mean, could pick up some Steam with them.
And Gears 1 PC was 2007.
Pick up some Steam.
And so, picks up some Origin.
Some,
it's one of those things when you have a game
like BattleNet.
GOG. Some GOG.
You know, but nostalgia is great, but when you actually go back and look at what you made, you know, 10 years later, it doesn't necessarily hold up, and you have to make it kind of more contemporary.
What were some of those challenges? Like, for instance, if I've played the Gear of War franchise, what's new in it for me from the PC perspective?
Well, from the PC perspective, all of those things I just rounded off.
Everything I just said.
But, I mean, essentially, one of the things we're doing is we're taking a lot of that PC content and we're bringing that over to the console so they get to enjoy it. But being able to sort of just expand on what you have in terms of, again, you know, all the different options you can get into. But from the, just an overall game perspective, the difference between the original to the way the remastered is just we rebuilt everything from the ground up. You know, we started with the core simulation, but there's over 3,000 art assets fully replaced. We have 19 multiplayer maps. We've got a bunch of new modes.
Really, want some egos. You know, I can go for some egos.
How people play Gears of War multiplayer. We found that TDM was the best
Do
way
it,
to
man.
Play socially, and King of the Hill was the best way to play competitively.
You have them?
And so we took those two modes.
I have
Gears
two, but I want
back
like
to the
six.
Ultimate Edition so that people can play the way they want to play now.
You cut them.
Like that. There's a lot of little tweaks that walk this line between nostalgia and contemporary shooter in 2015.
What about some of the other features?
Put some pieces of bread between them.
You could print out.
Well, you know, the standard stuff that comes
print out. Four more.
DVR, like all the things
you have
to be able to take advantage
like,
of.
Do you have a printer?
Computer.
Well, awesome. Now, of course, are there other things in the future that the PC
can support
from? No, print, like on paper. Right?
Nothing
yeah.
to announce.
No, of course.
Yet.
That makes sense.
Not 3D print.
So, that'll be something we'll be happy to talk about at a later time.
Okay. Well, great, guys. Thank you so much
all
for
right,
coming out,
of
ladies
war.
And gentlemen. Xbox Initiative.
Finally.
For PC.
Good job,
gentlemen.
Good job.
Thank you.
PC.
Yeah, don't say goodbye. Mr. Spector.
Now, of course,
fucking asshole.
This is a moment that I was asked to do. I resisted, but if you're looking for the one moment when Day 9
He's
sold out,
put it
it's
on.
Right now. Stay with me. For any of you who are familiar with a company called SCS Software, they make a game called Euro Truck Simulator.
Oh my God.
They are expanding west with all brand new content.
This is, where they lose me.
I've read about this, and I've heard that they're like traffic jams and stuff where you just sit in traffic for like half an hour or longer. Yeah.
No, like 3 hours apparently. That's.
And they just like talk to each other.
Yeah.
You like rush home to get like back into like traffic.
I don't understand why people like this game. I don't get it at all.
How big a following does it have?
Like, I even struggle sometimes with, like, those survival games that are kind of, like, aimless. Like, there's no real point to them.
Yeah.
But this is, like, that much further into, like, tedium.
Yeah, it's mind-numbing.
I'd rather just take a nap.
Yeah,
or just sleep.
If you enjoy driving trucks that much, like, do it as a job and get paid for it.
Sure.
Well, if you enjoy killing people in games so much.
On the drive that I took from San Francisco to LA to be here, you can do it in American Truck Simulator. Yeah. It was actually made using Google Maps, which is totally sweet.
The point is one is a job.
The other one's illegal.
Yeah, that's how I found here.
Something
now,
like
one of the big elephants in the room in PC gaming right now is virtual reality. Everyone's excited about it. We heard AMD talk about how they're developing technology specifically for it. But it's unclear exactly what the killer app is, what the killer experience is that will bring VR to the forefront.
Here it is, Half-Life.
The man that I'm about to
Half-Life.
On the stage, he has some ideas with a product called Eve Valkyrie. Let's bring on to the stage
I thought
Ryan
he was saying he had one
CCP.
More guess. I guess he's got numerous more guests.
Hey, John. Ryan, hey!
I think
welcome.
He had one more guess for the Xbox stuff.
Now, Ryan, right
the Microsoft
off the bat,
stuff.
Oh, I see. That makes a lot more sense.
A few years ago, and it, you know, felt a little
this press conference is never going to end.
The movement of a character.
How I thought this was supposed to go from like 6 to 8, or is it 6 to 9?
Eve Valkyrie
PSD.
Nice.
Yeah, so
I don't know.
With Valkyrie, we are trying to essentially
know.
Make the essence of space. Combat.
You don't know, do you?
So
I'm like
you
really
right
disappointed by this
press
conference. It's like the first ever PC gaming show, and this is what they fucking put together.
Shooting you out of a tube into space and basically just surrounding
it's
you.
It's like so
space.
Underwhelming.
So you know,
yeah, they could have just had a bunch of like awesome videos and people like.
You know, you're really
I don't know,
to
like choreographed
games.
Dancers.
So, yeah, and I actually got
the well, no, okay, fine. Like,
and,
like the one, the one
let's watch
criticism I've had of this whole thing is
right
like
first
some of the press conferences are like way over the top, but this could be
so.
This is like
somewhere
a
in the
too,
middle.
Yeah, a little bit too underwhelming.
So let's see what happens.
Holy shit!
I have to kill the enemies. Get them, kill them, shoot them. Come here.
Kill them.
Look at me go. Shit, I'm gonna fall over.
Like, there isn't even music in the background.
Oh my god! Oh my god, that is so.
Is Eve Valkyrie?
Yeah.
My proudest moment.
It's a sexy looking audience.
I cannot stress how intensive an experience it is to sort of look up in the cockpit and just to see and then to try to steer the whole ship. I mean, do you find players, you know, overwhelmed playing for such long periods of time and such an intense, visceral experience?
Yeah, I think once you get it, it's fine. And you can play for a long time, just like you would any other competitive shooter. But we find that when people first put on the headset and they get in the cockpit and they're out there in space, they're not looking around them at first because it's not natural to do that. We're used to playing on a 2D plane where the thumbsticks or the mouse and keyboard control our character.
But it's funny.
Valkyrie,
I mean, you can do
you really
that
get situational awareness by moving your head around
with
at all times,
2D
your head
screen,
on a looking up above you,
just like a control,
you know,
to
seeing
look
where
left
your
and
teammates
right.
are, where the enemies are, and once that clicks for you, once you
yeah, but there's not the connection with the
really
physical
feel
like,
you're like there.
Yeah,
mechanism
of
moving your head, right?
It's kind of weird to not
just creates
be there
that
all of a sudden because that's
yeah,
how
I mean,
immersive
I,
it is.
New level
I
of immersion.
Immediately, maybe sit down next time you play instead of standing up. Just
also, you feel more surrounded by the world, obviously.
Design elements
yeah, because you can't escape it. That's true.
You can't escape it, but also it's in your peripheral vision, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, first of all, this game was built completely from the ground up.
All you see is game.
So,
it's
yeah, it was born on VR. We did not make a game first and bring it over.
I need to
so
do one set on
for
that.
For us, it was about learning won, how to make games in VR.
Good
great.
Job. You gonna play another one?
Done before in this on this level.
Never inviting that motherfucker back.
How does the UI work? the different focal lengths. Like, you don't want to be looking at something up close and then having to switch very quickly.
Yeah, I mean, do simple menus become impossible in this sort of environment?
Yeah, I mean, we have to think about it differently. I mean, you don't want to be pulling down menus and having things all over the screen. You have to interact.
They need more voice
really
activated stuff, I think.
Fluid. Our goal is actually really to put you there, to have that sense of presence and immersion and make you feel like you're in the cockpit and to be really in the moment with you, your teammates, fighting against the other team. So, I mean, everything from how you use cover in VR and tactics that you would use as a team, it's all different. I mean, that station there, you know, in a real match, you could go all the way under and around and up above to use that as cover.
Oh, I did that. That freaked
me out. I guess that's the one thing about VR is you can't really make... Can you make
big endeavor to
non-first-person games?
What is CCP's sort of long-term view on VR?
Like, how are you going to make a third-person
very, very big
game? Yeah, you could.
There's some third-person stuff in VR.
Because, like, let's say you're doing, like, SimCity. Like, you could look over at certain buildings and, like, reach in and touch them.
Yeah, fair enough. Fair enough.
You could even play, you can have a board game.
Yeah.
Right, you're
right. It's like, you know, it's not, I don't think it's for every kind of game, obviously.
Isn't there that Microsoft tech that basically, like, texturizes, like, I guess that's still first person.
Yeah, you should check out the demo they did during the Microsoft press conference. It was pretty awesome.
Yeah, but it's kind of bullshit, too, here.
Yeah,
like your actual field of vision is much smaller than they were letting on.
Yeah, it was an impressive demo though.
I've heard people like who've used the current version of it, and they're like not.
This game is really all about
they're not like wow. It's like yeah, it doesn't.
Getting you out, getting you into combat. It's
mine's not blown.
Competitive, you know, space combat.
How was your set?
It's very different than Eve.
I take half-hour breaks between sets.
Skid lift maximum weight every time.
Gate camp knows, but it's also.
I don't know if it's bad or good,
you know,
but it's what I do.
It's a lot more too about you know the metagame, the politics, the corporations.
So it takes you like 24 hours to do your workout.
And the intensity of combat.
And for any of you who have not gotten the chance to try it, I strongly recommend you give it a shot. It is an absolutely insane, intense experience, and I can't wait to see it in full form.
It'd be fun to go to E3 one year.
Appreciate it.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, so it's a 3 hour, so we've got another hour, I guess.
It's 3 hours?
Our very next guest
is
one of the creators of a game called DayZ.
Jesus.
Oh.
Square Enix is...
he worked on DayZ.
He's only been live for an hour, dude, not 2 hours.
...in his upcoming project, so please join me in welcoming Dean Hall from Rocketworks.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
Yeah, we started at 9.
I have a stream counter thing.
Now, Dean, I want to start right away by talking about early access. You're one of the people with the biggest range of
experience
with early access.
What
do you feel like the status?
He looks like an Azerbaijani.
I say, I kind of have mixed feelings in some ways. Like, it's given us games like Kerbal Space
and he sounds
Program,
like one too.
Prison Architect. But
okay, maybe it's only 2 hours.
It also has its challenges.
I think it's only 2 hours. 3 hours is a bit ridiculous. Right. Even 2 hours is a bit long.
Refund Program has helped a bit with maybe perceptions and stuff like that. But it's challenging as a developer, particularly when your game gets really popular.
Now, that seems sort of paradoxical. I feel like most people would say, oh, it's great to be popular, but what was the strain that you were under?
Well, I mean, one of the advantages of early access is, like with Kerbal Space Program, the scope was allowed to get bigger. But if your game gets really popular and you're continually redefining your scope, then you kind of lose perspective of your roadmap. And I think that's why I feel the roadmap's super important.
Yeah, and what exactly would that constitute? Like, if you were working on another early access project, how would you want to communicate it outwardly to the consumer?
I played a game called Neo Scavenger, and hopefully people know it, it's PC gamers, so it had a really great roadmap that told you like what stuff was completed, and I think that was something I learned as being super important, because otherwise people don't have a picture of where your game's at.
So with your upcoming game, Ion, let's take a look at some of the trailer footage, and you know, I want to know, what, in your eyes, is the first big target?
The hero stuff's at the end of the show.
Well, I think...
Okay, so I'll see you in, like, an hour?
A great game is
I might go make my Eggos.
...than what you do. So,
3D,
I guess, in some ways...
2D printed Eggos?
...to describe what this isn't. You know, it's not Star Citizen, it's not Elite, it's not Eve. We wanted to look at what happens inside the stations. So, We're using a more Diablo-style camera. It's based on a game that I absolutely love called Space Station 13. Has anyone played Space Station 13 out there? Yeah, look at that.
You so, and you and you.
Honk,
yes.
Honk, honk, honk. So, yeah. I guess that's kind
of... All right, I'm going to make this echo, so I'll be back.
Yeah, I'm actually
okay, I'll hold him down, guys.
This sort of footage...
Got
sort
of fucking one guy making egos, one guy working out playing Dota 2. I like my old... old crew better.
We're trying to give people an opportunity to see what it's like to...
Fucking working out and making egos during the show.
So we're sort of stitching together these regions and then allowing players to have their own region and then, you know, walk around the region. So, yeah, I mean, we wanted to get back from that first-person view and actually get back into that Diablo-style view. So it becomes more about what you're doing in the game.
So is it not a 3D environment, or is it like 2D
it is,
with like a Z
no,
plane?
No, it's a 3D environment. It's okay. Not true isometric, but yeah. Offset camera.
So, I mean, I know that there's a lot of ambition going into this project, and there's some people that feel like you abandoned the DayZ project. It had such a huge, ambitious scope. I mean, it pretty much spawned the zombie survival genre. And then you departed. I know a lot of people were upset. I mean, I think even on your Twitter it said that you're going to block people who talk about DayZ.
I did for a while, yeah.
Nice.
I didn't, though. Like, yeah. That's kind of stupid.
Well, now you can mute them. I'm kidding. Please tweet at me at Day9TV. Now, well, I'm curious how, with that stigma, how you try to shirk that and deal with that when you're working on this next project.
Yeah, I think a lot of it comes down to, you know, learning the lessons. And I think that when I first came up with DayZ, it was an accident. I mean, it was a mod that I thought maybe 50 people would play, but a lot of people played it. And when I first looked at what to do, I realized I didn't have the resources, and so I sold it to Bohemia, who I knew had the ability to make the game. And I stayed a lot longer than I'd originally intended, but, you know, Ion is an example of a game that I've always wanted to make, and yeah, so it's a challenge, and I think really it's now about me proving that I have learned lessons and that, yeah, we deliver on stuff.
So. What do you expect to be a timeline to where we can begin to get our hands on?
So this is interesting. So he's basically admitting that DayZ is a complete failure and it will never be completed.
We're very conscious that to really make early...
I know he's not working on it anymore, but still, he's kind of...
make a decent game, we need to have more of a Besieged-style approach.
Kind of what he's admitting.
Who's played Besieged?
Are you still there?
Yeah, look at that. It's good, right?
I so, built a catapult.
Is there fucking anyone here? Am I just talking to myself?
Yes.
So that's what we're doing.
Ion.
We don't have an exact time frame for that. We've already pushed a couple of times. Yeah.
Now, because we only have a short time left, I have to ask, having played DayZ, I want to know for Ion.
At least Andrew Wallace is shitting on everything. He's participating.
Yeah. So,
he has a London shirt on. I like
recently,
that.
When you were clicking on another player, all their...
But he's from Azerbaijan, right?
So, yeah.
We...
Yeah, Andrew, you're talking about Andrew?
It's a persistent game, so
yes,
when your brain
Andrew
fell
Wallace.
Out,
yeah.
you couldn't do anything. So, and also your liver is kind of important.
And if a kidney falls apparently. Out, you're actually okay. You have another kidney, right?
That's right. Yeah. Although all your organs fell out, so.
So you have realistic organ simulation?
Yeah,
in
yeah. Mm. The technology
what?
We're using.
Realistic organ simulation.
The company that I've partnered for a joint venture in London. Uh-huh. They've made this amazing technology that allows us to simulate all entities in the world, and I think that's. What's really been able to allow us to double down on the concept.
Mm. Well, you've teased a lot of cool ideas. I look
what?
Forward to it.
Like, how does that improve gameplay, having
Gamers.
Organ
Thank
simulation?
You should get shot in something, and then you'll,
I'm going to step around my chair in the unusual suitcase brought from AMD that I'm not entirely sure what's inside, because this is now a time to halt talking and to do the first live demo on stage. Yes, thank you for buying into that. The game is going to be one that you may have seen on Kickstarter that had one of the best Kickstarter videos of all time. It's a game called Strafe. Please join me in welcoming, from Pixel Titans, Tom Glunt and Stephen Rainey. Hello.
I still can't believe that guy's using cue cards for all this.
Let's go ahead and get set up over here on the side. Now, I've seen the Kickstarter video, and I want to know a little bit about what the inspiration for Strafe is.
The inspiration for Strafe is paying homage to the games we love in our
childhood.
How
you tell
Doom,
I do. There's I tell there's no crying
giving
in baseball.
Infinite replayability.
Yeah, I mean, like, well, first let's talk about the environment. My understanding is that
everything in the game has a procedurally generated component to it. So in terms of the environment, the
volume's a bit low,
is everything we're seeing procedural or handcrafted rooms?
These are all
handcrafted.
I can hear the keyboard.
Each zone will have 40 to 50 rooms in it, filled with entrances, exits, different geometry, and secrets. And the engine kind of, you know, puts them together. They'll unlock them, change things.
I heard you, man. They turned up the volume.
Enemies have behaviors.
On the mic.
So every time you jump in, it should be a different experience.
And you talked about,
I think Day 9's not talking enough. I think he should talk one more time before the whole thing's over. See if they listen. It's a test to see if they're actually listening to
me. Yeah, we have a bunch of monster closets in the game tied to different events, as well as just having unique levels and very different gameplay experiences in the secret levels.
So how do you play test the sort of procedurally generated environment? I mean, do you have fears of redundant content, people re-entering the same rooms again?
T-talked.
By all means. We have a lot of scripting that will tell the levels how to behave, and just through playing them again and again and again, we're able to find the things we like and we don't like and just work around it.
And in terms of these monsters, is there a fixed set? Do they randomly get paired with the room? Because I'm noticing this sort of rock monster is the first time we've gotten a chance to see them.
Oh yeah. This whole zone is brand new. We're showing it off here first. Some of these enemies are
got your egos,
brand
buddy.
New, and you know, they all have different behaviors. They don't just see.
I was getting on stream earlier
so,
today
you know,
too.
The rock monster, he starts in a hiding state. He'll aggro, and then there's
Dick.
Different, I guess, waves of his behavior.
I gotta say, I love the very chunky bullets. Each bullet is clearly a rectangular prism. I mean, I know you've talked about the goal of being an homage to these old games, but you do have the opportunity to use more advanced technology. Mm-hmm. Where do you ride the line between wanting new and fresh and wanting to stick true to the old vision?
Well, we wanted to bring, you know, things that couldn't happen back then to the game. So we have all of the blood and the guts in the game are persistent. So every time you play, you just can paint rooms red. You can, you know, cover them with this acid. So if you actually step on the acid, you'll get hurt. So you can actually, like, put yourself into a corner. And with, you know, these weapons, you just picked up a rocket launcher. And you can't reload these, like, these weapons we're using as power-ups.
This game actually does look like a lot of fun.
And they turn into a different type of weapon, with the rocket launcher turned into like a baseball bat melee-style weapon.
So this is a gun that we're about to see thrown?
Yes.
It actually, yeah. It was,
so when my
more
my
the graphics are more Quake 1.
Yes. When you start the game, you choose
level.
Between a machine gun, a railgun, and a shotgun.
Okay.
And those will be your core weapons throughout the game, in which you level them up. You kind of, they adapt and evolve.
Is that a fish?
And, you'll kind of always default back to those, but there'll be plenty of things for you to fight within the game.
Fish grenade?
So, of course, I gotta know, what is the sort of expected gameplay loop like of someone who sits down to play?
Well, you jump in, you shoot stuff in the face, you paint shit red, and then you die and do it over again. So,
clean and elegant. You should hang out with Tripwire.
Love those guys.
Thank you so much for showcasing Strafe. Again, guys, please check it out.
Thanks
the Kickstarter video. Is hilarious. The persistent shooter. Gentlemen, thank you for coming out and showcasing today. Oh, setting up the next game for us as well. Oh, such
Always.
A gentleman. Now, there's a genre of game that I grew
I
up
I kind of like that demo, too. It was like simple, to the point.
One and two.
It's actually talking about the game as opposed to just hype.
And the fact that there's a renaissance of these classic RPGs has me so excited. Has
it seems right up your alley.
Absolute pleasure to announce the upcoming expansion to Pillars of Eternity, The White March.
Pillars of Eternity.
Cad Nua is restored by your hand, and word of that deed has traveled far. I write from the White March beneath the shadow of Durgan's Battery. The impenetrable fortress, the last hope of my dying town. Deep within, the legendary White Forge lies dormant, unclaimed since the Builder's disappearance. It stands as an immense opportunity. Others have tried and failed.
No, it's Pillars of Eternity expansion.
Reclaim the secrets of Durgan Steel.
It's called Half-Life
Forge 3.
Pillars of Eternity Half-Life 3. Brought to you by Tom Clancy.
So we got a good idea of the gameplay there.
It's only part one? What? Pillars of Eternity, The White March, part one.
It's time to welcome the CEOs of Obsidian and Paradox, Fergus, Urquhart,
I think they need another subtitle there.
Hey, welcome back.
All right,
nice
good to see you.
Oh, well, there needs to be a traffic light up here, I know. Thank you so much. Now, of course, simple question.
Yes.
Tell us about the White March.
Well, the White March is the first part of the expansion we're doing for Eternity. It's a whole lot more Eternity. I mean, we've been making RPGs for years. And the funnest thing about doing expansions is you get to just add more, and we're doing more companions, we're doing soulbound weapons, we're doing higher level cap, we're doing a ton of stuff. And of course, you know, what we're really known for a lot is all of the dialogue and the writing, and we're doing even more than we did for the main game.
And, you know, I know that Pillars of Eternity was kickstarted for $4 million, and now you're teaming up with Paradox. Friend, talk to me a little bit about your partnership.
Well, we've known each other for a couple of years, so we know each other pretty well, and we
too well sometimes.
Sometimes too well. We can sit for hours and discuss whether Highlander is a great movie or.
This guy's Mexican, right?
And that's great.
Yeah.
So such a jab to put in there. I love that.
So when the opportunity came,
it really should bring out a translator for.
It's perfect because we want to work long term with
these guys. That are speaking, you know, like Spanish and shit.
Their audiences, just like we are at Paradox as well.
Yeah.
So it was a perfect match. We even had like close to 20 people at Paradox who had been backers in the Pillars of Eternity Kickstarter.
Oh, awesome.
Yeah, yeah. And I think, you know, a big thing about, I think what's great about teaming up with Paradox, I mean, they're guys that think like we do about games. They love PC games. They love the weird games that we make and hardcore. And so, and it's just it's great now to kind of see this kind of new way of seeing games published and being able to work with people that kind of really. Like, it's not these giant console games, which are great, but it's great that we can now offer, like, different games that are, that, you know, 5 or 6 years ago might have been hard to do.
Well, I mean, I know that many people consider Pillars of Eternity to be sort of one of the darlings of the Kickstarter movement, but there's also there's so much controversy in there with projects asking for small budgets, because some games need $10 million to make the minimum viable prototype, but, you know, with $4 million,
how do you
balance that in, with the community expectation, as well as wanting to make a good game?
Well, I think, first of all, we're old. You know, and so we've been doing, this for a while, right? And we and particularly back at Black Isle Studios, you know, we worked on Planescape Torment, we worked on Icewind Dale.
Planescape Torment. Sorry, go on.
Sorry, that's okay. All I'm really responsible for is the combat, and the combat wasn't that great. So,
J9 you know, did really not correct
how to make
there.
Those games. We always wanted to continue to make those games, and so when we got the
the combat was great. You're not old.
In between when the game came, the game kickstarted and kind of towards launch.
Stop speaking Spanish.
So, you know, for about five, and ended up being our budget was about $5.5 million. So we were able to do it. Yeah, really close to kind of what we got out of Kickstarter.
Wow. I mean, from a publisher's perspective, I mean,
a lot of developers are using Kickstarter as more of a, like, proof of concept kind of thing, like a litmus test now, like to get, like they need some goal in order to get some publisher interested in the game or some funding, some like outside funder interested in the game as well, something they're not really talking about.
That has been something kept us away.
Like the guy that developed the Castlevania games, he's making, he left, is it Capcom? No, who was Konami that developed the Castlevania games? He left, right, and he started a Kickstarter campaign for another Castlevania-like game, and I think he was only asking for like $200,000. But that clearly wasn't enough to make the game. But it's just he's just trying to get buy-in from the crowd out there to prove that he can, you know, there's interest for it, so that other people will invest.
Right.
And it's just to like, no, if the, you know, we really should only do 6 classes, so let's do 11. You know, and a lot of that is
the fellow on the left, the Mexican.
Can
offer much, and I think we even did to an extent. But in
probably,
the end, you know, I think it's all about. I think
or just concrete.
And what I'm proud of is really that we said we're going to make this. Because
his hair isn't actually gray.
And
it's like,
and I feel we did.
It's red. His hair is.
And
he's a redhead.
Super thankful to all our
it's the concrete that's making it gray.
I'm super excited to see the White March soon, guys. Thank you so
much
for coming
out. Thank you.
Yep. Fergus Frederick.
You can see that guy's.
I saw some skin there.
I saw some skin.
How are you guys enjoying yourselves tonight?
I'm aroused.
So far, so good? We cover a lot of material on this show. And our next guest is a name that many of you know. He is a legendary creator of Elite and Elite Dangerous. He is the CEO of Frontier Development.
There's a real range of.
David Braben.
Thank
you very much. Well, yeah, it's PC gaming, right? So, sky's the limit.
Thank you.
And even sometimes, that's not the limit.
PC gaming,
And we at Frontier are proud to be a
as we'll see here
with Elite Dangerous.
With Elite
We've
Dangerous.
Had three great updates to the game already.
It's a space game. Launch.
But that's just the start.
Wow, this guy's got... Uh-oh.
Sorry.
Woo! Wow, that's weird.
Yeah!
I thought it was a deliberate
That's
pause.
Just the start. There is so much to come on PC to announce soon. But today, I want to talk about something a little different. It's a game we've wanted to make for a long time. Another game we've wanted to make for a long time. It's the revival of a great genre, and it's coming to PC
called...
in 2016. It's available for pre-order now on the Frontier Store. And this
He's
is what it.
It
looks like.
He did it.
He did it. Wow. Oh, man, that's kind of... I feel bad for that guy. Quickly, what's the genre that they're reviving? What's the prediction?
Adventure?
That's already been revived.
I don't know, what do you think?
Puzzle game?
I'll give you that idea. It looks pretty good, to be honest.
Yeah, but it's not
Unless it's just a cinematic.
This is a cinematic.
If this were the game, it would be great.
Oh, it's a theme park thing. I get it now. That's cool. People would be excited about that.
Really?
Yeah. They haven't made a good one in a while, I think.
Really? They stopped making these?
Maybe. I'm assuming. By the way, he introduced it.
Thank you so much, David. That's a very different tone from Elite Dangerous.
That's so sarcastic.
It's lovely. Now we have a very different.
Get that guy off the stage.
The one that would be very hard to develop.
No, seriously, I feel bad for that guy.
Please join me in welcoming the director of ArenaNet.
He was just so overwhelmed.
For Guild Wars 2,
yeah.
Heart of Thorns, Colin Johansson. Welcome.
Here you go.
If he hadn't said sorry, it would have been fine.
Colin.
He shouldn't have said sorry.
Hey, yeah, don't apologize.
Never apologize.
Now, Colin, I know there's a lot of content in Heart of Thorns.
There is.
And one of the
this guy forgot his.
No, he missed it. He missed it, that motherfucker.
Yes.
Where did you go?
To reveal a world exclusive.
Where did you go?
Halls feature.
Where did you go?
Yeah, that's right. For Guild Wars 2 He's Heart gone again.
We believe that these online worlds
he crawled back
really
into the hole.
Creating opportunities to bring players together. That's why we make games. Hundreds of players.
Little Dota 2 hole.
Makes sense for an MMO. Yes, let's not keep separated.
And Guild Halls is our answer
He's
to
back.
How we allow these players that we're bringing together to have a truly meaningful impact.
I turn the volume down on
it. And to own a part of that world.
Not you
guys. Brought a world exclusive trailer here today
Never.
To show what they look like.
Well, let's take a look.
Have you guys played Guild Wars at all or no?
No. I like that it's not a, it wasn't a subscription-based MMO, you just purchased it.
It was free-to-play, yeah.
No, it wasn't free-to-play. You bought it, and then it was free afterwards. So.
But it became pretty big, right?
Is this Guild Wars?
Yeah.
Yeah. So what happened was there was a bit of an awkward moment with one of the presenters. After he first came out, he kind of I think he was a bit overwhelmed, and he paused and said, "You know, I'm sorry," and then got back into it after a few moments.
PC gaming, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah, he looked
pretty cool.
I don't know. Maybe he's got
Brad Pitt-esque.
I don't know. I don't want to speculate what his issue is. It's a Canadian bacon-ish
presence.
Yeah. Like how he keeps just disappearing randomly. Oh, you can decorate your hall. Yeah. Are you guys, like, into this? I already know the answer, but are you into this, all this, like, crafting and, like, decorating shit and, like...
No. And the Fallout 4 thing?
Yeah, the Fallout 4 thing as well.
Not really. I'm glad you said it's, like, optional.
Optional, yeah.
It's kind of cool, like... I hope it doesn't become the focus of the game, that's all.
It's too time-consuming for me to really get into it, I think.
I don't know, I think it is exciting, like, to play. I never really played an MMORPG, a MORG, but, I mean, to the extent that you can build, like, a house and, like, I don't know.
Most MMORs didn't even have that, though.
Yeah, and, like, improvement and stuff, that's pretty neat.
It's neat, yeah, it's just not something that I probably use.
I don't have the time to commit to it, but I could see the appeal.
Yeah, for sure. Building your own little spaces in the world.
And, like, Ultima Online had that a lot, right?
It still makes me laugh, because you described guild halls as a social feature. But that looked like a lot of shit. Yeah,
said the S word, guys.
Guild halls are a lot more than a hall. They are an entire map that your guild gets to own. And the way these work is basically the map begins owned by the jungle dragon and its armies. And the guilds will band together, they'll fight their way into the jungle, and they'll actually fight their way through this hall to capture the map for their guild. Once they own it, it becomes basically their home to customize, personalize, grow, and develop. And jungle there's track. So many.
I like the idea that you have to like capture the area. It kind of creates a sense of ownership. More of a sense of ownership, I guess.
You can take your guild team out. You can compete in the competitive PvP leaderboards and compete to the top of our world leaderboards, which is a new feature we're adding with guild halls. You can go on guild missions through the guild portal, where it opens up
a portal
your
good,
entire
actually.
Guild can take. And all together, you can go out in the world and you can complete guild puzzles, go on guild treks, guild races.
And guild guilds.
Itself, you can build all these different buildings as well as your
guild buildings.
Grows. There's so much customization in here and fun.
Guild monsters.
Guildings? There's many mountains and gilds.
Guild mountains. Get it right.
There's a ton. I'll tell you about what some of these buildings are that we're looking at right now. For example, this first one that you can build is an arena. This is actually a combat sandbox that a guild can own. They can customize it. They can fight against their friends, their guild. They can invite other guilds in, and they can brawl against each other. You can decorate this arena. You can put up walls. You can set up traps. You can put down turrets. And you can even change the decorations live while combat is going on, while people are in there fighting against each other.
I wonder what kind of
another
usage
one of the buildings
you're
gonna
get.
You can build is the workshop. And the workshop is a place where we're adding an entirely new guild-specific crafting profession, where you can make items for all the people in your guild.
You can make guild items.
And within there as well,
I mean, like, but imagine this guild just makes this huge thing and then no one uses it.
Yeah. Well, actually, like...
Well, this was a very easy segment.
I think a lot of the fun of these things is actually just building it, not really using them.
Now, I mean, what is some of this that we're seeing right now on screen with this assault on this castle? Yeah, so one of the really cool buildings that you can build in your guild hall is actually the War Room. And the War Room allows you to build tools that you can take into our epic hundreds of players world versus world PvP.
Yeah.
And you can use these tools and take them with your guild. You can claim objectives and use those tools to help your guild attack and defend objectives.
What's the word of the day, guys?
So, for example, here, this guild is taking control of a castle, and they're actually able to call in airships that circle around and defend the castle and bombard it as long as the guild is
What's
able
the name
to
of the game?
And they can wage war against other
guilds
in world versus world through our war room. Well, you know, honestly, Colin, I'm just going to ask you a pretty simple question. Anything else you want to talk about today? part of the reason why I... joke about this is that I find MMOs to be such a difficult genre to develop for because people just rip through the content.
So he's about halfway through his cue cards, slightly
so
more than half.
This just looks like an incredibly
look at that stack of cue cards. Honestly, Jesus Christ.
Yeah, I thought that was a joke.
I've one more big.
No, he's using them, man. He's fucking using them.
That is very soon. We're going to be turning on pre-sales for Guild Wars 2: Heart of Thorns, and just like before the release of Guild Wars 2.
How are those egos, by the way?
You access to all of our
fantastic.
I haven't had an ego in a while. Maybe she get back into them.
Yeah. Loaded up with that real maple syrup.
Right now, so you can go
the real maple syrup on the fake waffle.
Yeah.
Well, Colin, thank you for making this segment extremely easy for me. Absolutely, yeah. And we hope to see everybody in our pre-purchase soon. Colin Johansson from ArenaNet. Thank you, Colin.
It's day 9, guys, knocking it out of the park.
Well, nice.
You know day 9 next?
What?
Is yet another.
Do you know of him?
I don't know anything about him. Then.
Oh, you don't? Okay. Like, this is the first time you've really seen him?
Yeah. What's the story?
Oh, okay. Well,
I've only known him from StarCraft.
Yeah, he was a big StarCraft. Like, he was StarCraft 1. He was a. I'm a pioneer in the casting realm.
Okay.
His brother still casts in Korea.
I might have seen him then. His brother.
He does.
I've been watching some of the.
Tasteless.
Right away, okay.
I've been watching some of the right away, StarCraft II stuff, actually.
The beta stuff?
Yeah, the Korean stuff.
Yeah.
Beta Korean, the beta.
Like GSL stuff? Or
the GSL stuff, yeah.
And it's pretty fun to watch, eh?
It is. The games are,
when you're in this place, are you just
I thought they would be longer, but some of them end, really, really fast. They, 5 minutes sometimes.
Yeah, that can be fast. Like a rush that succeeds.
So, I want to go ahead and take a look at some of the footage.
The control that you need in that game is just, insane.
When I got the chance to first look at this.
When you're, you're watching, a Protoss player.
It's a real multitasking game, actually. It's super multitask.
When you're controlling, a Protoss army, you've got to, constantly blink them out of range and things like that.
Yeah. Well, it's like that, and also keep going back and pumping out units and making more expansions. That's, the... Yeah. That's what really makes you good, really.
The Terran airdrops and stuff like that happen constantly.
That's
the
micro stuff.
That's
cute and stuff. But
well, I mean,
the micro and the macro, but the dexterity is insane. They're always they track APMs like actions per minute. The pros have 300. And then I have 60, and Bacon has 90 or something. I don't know. Or Bacon would.
No, he's got 30 because he's doing fucking seven things at once.
I got that high, 120.
So Hitman guys, Hitman, I'm excited about this.
Are you? Yeah. It was just a CG, wasn't it? Well,
that sounded I know, but I'm just excited in general about a new Hitman game.
Optical illusion.
I like Blood Money. That's the only Hitman game I really like with Blood Money.
I'm finding that Agent 47 is starting to look a lot Billy Crudup.
Come here. Lean close. No, this is.
Is there supposed to be sound for this?
Brace me warmly.
I don't know.
I'll never let go.
This is Hitman.
Whisper the hits sweetly.
Welcome to the show, dude.
So, all right. So what you're seeing there in the footage is it's Paris. It's a location called Paris, and
it's a city, and it's called Paris.
Yeah, I mean.
People live in it.
The locations we have
very close to
there's buildings. It's because his mic's not working.
Compared to the older games, they're 6-7 times bigger. A lot more NPCs in there. A lot more complex, deep, high definition.
Oh, he changed his cue card.
And, you did talk to me before about the idea of live events being a core piece. I mean, can you expand upon them? I mean, right now, for instance, we're at this fashion show.
Right. So Hitman is, a new bold move for us. Before, we've been working years on a game and put it in the box and just put it out there, right? Just hoping everything went well, right? Some things gamers would love, and some other things, we could have tweaked that, right?
Right.
So what we're doing right now, we are launching the experience at 8th of December, digital launch, where we'll have the opportunity to grow, deepen, and expand the universe. We call it the world of assassination, right? So, work that with our gamers and community to get input to, tweak the features, but also make sure that the content that will evolve and come later will be the best possible Hitman experience for them.
And I want to come back to something you said earlier where
you said
the size of these kinds of simulations that you could run is so much larger. What does that sort of specifically entail?
Right, so compared to the levels we've been doing before, for example, let me put it this way. So Hitman is the best that we have from the graphical fidelity from Absolution and the big sandboxes from Blood Money. That's just taken up to another level. So we're talking about 6-7 times bigger locations, no checkpoints. It's really the ultimate assassination experience, right?
And I mean, with so many extra NPCs and characters,
right?
I mean, one of the things that I always note about the Hitman games is how many players figure out weird, new, unusual ways to solve each mission. I mean, is this happening on a larger scale?
I do this when you just to control do it in real life. It is a job.
I mean, we create a game where we know that there is, almost open-ended ways of killing.
I don't really know how to answer that. I agree.
A surprise when we,
And you could actually combine this with Euro Truck Simulator, right? Because you could drive to the jobs. found a in new your Euro truck
cover. The target, right? And yeah. Then
with Absolution, we introduced contracts.
Kill them.
So once you're done with the targets in the campaign in the story, you can play contracts, play to create. Yeah. Right. Or you can use the sandbox, use the richness in it. And
I'm doing the set. Back.
And much,
we had his full attention for exactly 30 seconds.
Now, just going from the prior games to Hitman, just imagine, you know, we're going from 55 NPCs to over 300, put the crowd on top of that, and the sheer size of checkpoint-less locations we deliver here is amazing how deep...
Checkpoint-less, that's the word of the day.
That you can create.
And guilds.
Well, I mean, I have two things to say. For one, I mean, the graphics look absolutely beautiful. December 8th, you said, was the release?
Exactly.
December 8th, looking forward to the date.
It's quite
and
soon.
Of course, you smell amazing.
Considering they're not really showing... Doesn't look like they're actually showing gameplay. Like, it's just canned in-engine stuff.
Now, of course, the technology that is helping... Oh,
whoa, who's that guy?
The technology that is helping make this possible, we talked about a little bit earlier in the show. And I'm thrilled to get the chance to bring on right now the CEO of AMD, Lisa Su, to talk about some
AMD
of the product
again.
Lines
is
coming
AMD
up.
A big sponsor of this event?
It is, yeah. There.
Lisa,
John,
welcome.
How are you?
I'm doing great, Lisa.
You're doing fantastic.
I am doing just
wonderfully. I guess Microsoft
now,
is as well.
I just got the chance to look at some of the in-game gameplay footage.
I think it's
benchmarks you're trying
mainly AMD.
Goals you're trying to make to deliver the best quality experience for a game like Hitman.
Well, you know, you have had just an amazing group of people on the show today. And
right?
Just,
right?
Is it amazing?
Yes. Hey! That's
just
really,
really dark tea.
And I mean, it says something about where PC gaming is going. And for, you know, for us at AMD, it's about how do we enable those experiences.
She drinks a lot of coffee.
So
well, she's
a wonderful game. It's all about
South 4K. African, right?
It's all about enabling that experience and ensuring
no,
that we have
African.
The hardware to do that.
African.
So for us, it's, you know, how do we capture those key technologies that will enable that gameplay?
And when you talk about key technologies, I mean, I mentioned this a little to Richard, that, you know, you have people worried about video streaming, VR, just general performance on, you know, single player experiences. How do you balance all that sort of stuff?
You know, the key for us is to really develop a portfolio. You know, there's so many gamers out there, hundreds of millions of gamers, and everybody wants something different. So Richard talked about some of our new technology.
We've had
an incredibly busy day today, Sean. Incredibly
busy.
Nine
new blood
jobs. We launched 9 new cards.
Is this one of the launch cards that I see?
It's incredibly busy.
What is that?
You know, there are
a couple of cards
that I'm going to tell you about. Can I tell you about a couple of them?
Oh, you're a bit ahead of me.
Lisa, I would love it if you told me about a couple cards.
All right. Well, that's what I'm going to do then.
Let's do it.
So our flagship that we launched was the Radeon R9 Fury X. This is the first card with
is
high bandwidth
memory
that will be
on
available
the
in the industry. And it's a beautiful card. Actually, you have two of them in your gaming rig right over there. So this card has incredible performance at 4K.
It's a card?
Completely designed for DX12. And when you think about VR experiences, this is what we enable. And this is our flagship card.
No.
Now, we we have a few others.
Let's hear about some more cards.
I'm show you this one.
This is a real card. This is not a paper
watch. We usually
watch.
Think about gaming as, you know, these big honking cards.
Yes.
Well, with high small bandwidth card. Memory technology and our new technology, you can really do all kinds of neat things. So this is our newest Radeon R9 Nano.
A Master Chief Collection coming to PC, maybe.
Wow. Graphics card,
it like,
4K.
Larry, like Major Nelson, someone tweeted that, like Boogie, pretty big
long.
YouTuber.
You heard it here first, guys. Glad you decided to join in.
And then he texted me, he tweeted back saying message received.
It's surprisingly small.
But what we're really trying to show you is that new technology can really give you
a very different experience. It's smaller.
You know, sometimes you're going to want to build big gaming rigs. Sometimes you're going to want to build living room systems.
Yeah. Really don't like that she's rubbing her hand all
4K
over the
performance on
the connectors at the bottom.
And I know that you brought some unannounced stuff today.
Yeah.
We do have.
I'm wondering if I finally get to know about. Finally.
You might have a. Do you have a briefcase over there?
I have this case that's just been here. Is that okay?
It's a bomb.
John, you dropped my case on your desk here.
Yeah. Sorry. Should I be very?
Well,
I don't know what's in it.
Okay. So, a friend of mine is going to bring something on stage so that I can demonstrate the other technologies that we have here.
Ooh.
Ron.
From the upcoming Hitman game. What is this?
So, AMD is about innovation.
That guy looks nothing like Agent 47.
How can I take the technology that we described in hardware?
You know what? I think they planned that joke, which is the worst part.
Actually, a 16 teraflop gaming system.
This is gonna be something totally stupid. My bet.
Two of our new Fiji HBM GPUs.
Now, if you think about it,
this is a beautiful form factor. Everything, all the computing is encompassed here.
If you think about it.
Turn around, you
that's
can see
right.
All the ports.
So you can see all
side.
The ports.
I guess to be Vanna White.
I thought about it, and it doesn't
that
look beautiful.
Very good,
thank you. I'm very elegant.
And then we have a very elegant cooling system here. But if you think about the power in here, I said there were two Radeon R9 Fury X's in that machine.
VGs, vaginas.
GPUs in this machine.
VGs.
So to show you that the technology is real, by the way, this thing is working. It's running some beautiful VR demos upstairs. Why don't we
I don't understand what that little box does.
Wait, it's like wireless?
I don't know if I broke it.
That thing's running demos upstairs.
I'm sure you did okay. Let's take a look.
No, it's got a bunch of cables on it, so it's got to be upstairs.
There's like another one upstairs.
It's
okay.
It's literally glowing, and it is something I could have broken. What is it?
So, we wanted to save something for the PC gamers.
This is so
stupid.
For the
very, very first time, we are showing a dual Fiji GPU card.
Oh, on one card.
Oh. Wow.
This
and
is a card
it's also an excellent frisbee.
System, and it tells you what the technology is capable of.
That's my frisbee sound.
And I understand that these are upstairs right there right now for people to play with?
They're absolutely upstairs right there right now in Club AMD. So we have a bunch of wonderful games and demos up there. And, you know, the main message I wanted to make sure that we left with you is AMD is about gaming, and AMD loves PC gaming. So, Sean, thanks so much for having me.
I feel like they haven't really...
Out. You're like Santa!
They haven't told us about...
Look at all the toys!
We like the toys.
Do I get to just keep these here?
Don't think
fuck,
so.
Fuck, it's so embarrassing.
Well, we might come back next year, and then we'll talk about it.
Okay,
all right?
Well, I'll just keep the it's nice case here under the
I'm
table.
I'm taking the card. Ugh. He can keep the case. Thank you.
Thank you so much for coming out, ladies and gentlemen. Lisa,
Lucy
Lisa
Liu.
Sue,
there she goes.
CEO of AMD.
It's bordering on racism,
only
sir.
Only just left one
That's
thing.
Inappropriate.
So excellent.
Got it done.
Our upcoming guest.
Got it done.
Are known just as much.
Like, okay, what's the special thing? It's a another video card.
On top of from Virginia Interactive. Let's welcome.
What'd you
to
expect?
Stage.
Or it's
Joris
like a
Jan
fucking.
Van Atlen anyway, and Jay Crow.
Closed box.
Welcome.
I guess I shouldn't expect anything else.
Joris, Jay.
Perfect pronunciation.
Perfect pronunciation. 6.5 out of 10.
6.5 out of 10.
So I want to ask. Or I wanted to say right away, thank you so much, guys, for coming out. I love all the mods that your games are built on.
Yeah, it's awesome to be here, finally, an event dedicated to PC gaming at E3.
Yeah.
Thank you for setting it up.
Yeah, well, I mean, I know a little bit about what we're going to see. My understanding is it's something a little bit special that no one else has seen here yet today.
Correct. Did Day 9 actually set up the
expansion
the,
for Arma 3
the show?
For a couple of months? And it's finally the time now to show you the major component
yes.
of it. So let's roll the video.
Let's take a look.
World exclusive. That's chopping up a little bit.
Yeah. One thing I would suggest is totally closing chat. Not just like hiding it. There's actually an option in settings for chat.
What is this an expansion for?
Arma 2.
That it hides it and it just won't like. They'll stop.
It'll
stop your video from chopping a bit.
Lost.
Lost the game?
Yeah.
Europlane Simulator. Thank you. It's about time they released a new terrain for that game.
Is it, you would say it's the new terrain of the terrain of show?
Terrain piece. I mean, tell me.
Terrain of the show? Yeah.
Yeah. Well, welcome to Tanawa. It's
like the best terrain in the show. I totally agree with that. It's the
first time we've how do you turn off the chat? I only know how to hide it.
Yeah, it's like hide.
Oh, that's it.
Archipelago yeah, that does it.
It's sort of the crown jewel of, as Yara said, the expansion that we're working towards, hopefully the first half of 2016.
I mean, in all my playing of the Arma games, I've always felt like the terrain is the one of the most important characters of the
game. It's true. And, I mean, the terrain is the most important part of the game.
Not really found in the rest of the game.
But I mean, if you get if you take away the terrain, there's nothing.
Really fresh for the Arma series. And our environment lead monster is created from the very beginning as a green hell. So it's a bit more raw and more gritty
right,
than
buddy?
Your typical holiday resort. And I'm really looking forward to
hit that mute button.
Making some cool military scenarios in there.
Yeah. And I mean, I also saw that islands seem to be a pretty central component to that. I mean, is this going to change the way that the movement works for the player?
Well, it's certainly something new for the Arma series. I mean, I think like all of the terrains, which have been such a massive part of all of the games that we've made for the last 15 years, the Generous, the Altus, and now Tanawa, the core experience is the same. You know, it's a richly detailed, kind of authentic world. But definitely the islands, the archipelago, it's something new. It means exploring the islands a little bit
different. Be back in a second, guys.
Farewell.
You guys keep talking.
Underwater as well. Yeah, we'll keep going.
And we're looking forward to
wait, did Phil Spencer announce Killer Instinct for PC?
We talked about this right before you came on the stage, that you guys are such huge believers in modding. And this seems like a brand new toy for modders to play with.
Exactly. It's a whole new canvas for modders to do, to make all their creations on. Can be anything from authentic military experiences to completely crazy stuff. I'm looking forward to dinosaurs myself, for example.
Well, I mean, I'm also a little bit curious about, we've talked about the terrain extensively, but what are some of the other new features and gameplay that will be coming along with Tanawa?
Well, we definitely know that we make a game as a platform. So we have our own vision of what Arma 3 is, and we also have to think about the modders. So the features that we're bringing along, like we see some of the screen space reflections, we see the water technology, so it's going to look a little bit more beautiful. DX12 is going to be something that will really kick on the performance, which is a really important part of the Arma 3 experience. Like, we want to really nail that down for the expansion. And a few other things aside, like the expansion itself is really a content pack built around Tanawa, but also with weapons and vehicles and local factions competing.
Well, I'm super excited to see the game, and of course, what the modding community is going to do. I mean, Daisy, Take on Mars are just incredible experiences. So, again, from the bottom of my heart, thank you so much for your amazing support of the modding community, guys.
Right.
Bohemia Interactive.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Martin. Thank you.
Now, our next guest is working on an absolutely beautiful and unusual indie game called Beyond Eyes. Let's welcome to the stage Sherida Halato.
Hey!
Welcome!
Hey!
Thrilled to finally get the chance to meet you. Please, come join me.
All right.
Now, Sherida, I was wondering if you could tell me a little bit about the core gameplay of Beyond Eyes.
Okay, so it's an exploration game. And it literally means that if you don't explore, you don't get to see anything, because the whole world is completely white until you start walking around. So because she's blind, she kind of uses her other senses to visualize the world. So if she smells things, or if she hears certain sounds, she will just visualize them as she perceives them.
Okay, I'm back. Did I miss anything?
But then because she's kind of sheltered, she doesn't always have the right reference to pull from.
It looks like a Nintendo game.
And she thinks of something that she knows because it's familiar in a garden, for example, like a fountain.
Not really. No, it does.
But then when she comes closer and smell kind of starts coming in, she realizes this is not a fountain, it's actually a very nasty sewer drainage. And you kind of play with that.
I mean, the big thing that I always, you know, immediately strikes me when I see the footage is just the beautiful art style. But of course, audio is a really interesting...
This show is just, like, really boring, don't you find?
The problem is they're just all over the place. Like, if they should cater to, like, hardcore gamers and show all that in a segment, and then, like, this artistic crap show it, like, at a different time.
Similar to other
stuff. Yeah.
Like, they're just playing all kinds of random games. Like, I don't care about 80%
of
these.
And the same thing, like, we wanted to make sure that the way it's visualized works
right.
with that theme as well.
I mean, in terms
like
of the
shooting
art
game
style,
at the start, yeah, StarCraft 2, yeah.
Through, you mean you're talking about visual representations different from what it actually is?
Yes.
What was that
Heroes.
Process like of
yes.
testing these?
So you're interested in the stuff at the beginning and the stuff at the end? Nothing
yeah.
in between.
So, yeah, basically everything in the middle. I watch the Hitman stuff. Like, at least it's in the right genre,
and we would
or, like, they cater to the right demographic.
And, like, say to other people, other classmates,
like, I'm never going to play this.
Like, can you come in, you get a free cupcake, here's a bunch of sounds, the textures.
So do you think they should just not show stuff like this, or do you think they should just segregate it a bit more, like, have, like, this is kind of, like, the independent game section, this is the hardcore gamer section, this is the...
After that, it's just a lot of...
Yeah, like, more mature-themed stuff. Yeah. Like an artistic indie part.
And what has really been a big challenge for you as an indie developer working on a first-time title?
They shouldn't just clump it all together. Like, PC games, that's a little broad.
Basically, yes. So, beyond that, I think I was lucky that I never...
They did that a bit better in the other press conferences. Like, there was distinct, like, we're going to show you, you know, for Xbox, these are the independent games that are
going to
come out next year.
I probably would have contained myself a little better, but because I didn't know, I kind of...
Or if you are going to show this, show it in, like, 30 seconds of video and, like, don't bring someone out to talk about it.
It's kind of funny how close it was to, like, the technology talk, too, as well, right?
That's funny.
Certainly a good lesson for a future
Who's this?
Project.
Well, I've said this before, and I will continue to say it.
It's
absolutely beautiful. And I
creator of some artistic
so much,
game with about a little girl who travels around.
Yeah, she's Italian.
Now, our next guest game you may have seen if you've been tuning into Twitch lately, as many of the top streamers have been blasting each other to death in it. It's a game called Dirty Bomb we're going to bring to the stage, the CEO.
Wow, there is
Dustin
Browder at the very end.
I don't think this has been at the top of Twitch.
For the past 10 years, we've been so fortunate to work on some of the world's biggest intellectual properties, Wolfenstein.
The biggest game on Twitch right now is probably Ark.
Batman Arkham Origins, and we've just
announced our collaboration survival game.
With the Coalition on Gears of
War. No, it's the top channel.
But today is actually a real first for us, because
it's talking about Dirty Bomb.
The first shooter in the entire history of Splash Damage that we own, that's actually our game. And that control gives us a completely unique approach to the way that we make it. Just 9 months after starting, more than 2 years ago, we involved the whole community in the game in our private forums, and we've had tens and thousands of messages
I don't even see it.
In support of the game, giving us feedback on competition,
What's this one?
Collaboration, and so on.
Dirty
so we're
bomb?
Really pleased to there announce this trailer. Head on over to the PC Gamer website for a giveaway of a mercenary called Fragger. You can get your Steam code there today and view the full
Thank
version
you.
Of this trailer as well. Thank you very much.
There's like, mission Rising Storm to Vietnam.
Some men There's like 200 people watching it.
Honor,
I don't
justice,
know.
Freedom. Some call these men heroes. We call them scrubs. Guys, ready the fuck up. We're not soldiers, we're hired guns. And there's only one thing we fight for. A coal.
They're not showing any Overwatch, are they? I don't think so.
Destroy the primary objective.
Well, they have their BlizzCon for that.
I don't know why they wouldn't do that. I guess they want to talk more about the games that are currently out. But that's not really what E3 is for. You're usually announcing.
Yeah. They're very careful about not cannibalizing their sales. Like, they stagger releases and so on, so I guess they're just pumping up Heroes right now.
See you later.
Trick or treat, motherfucker.
StarCraft, Legacy of the Void.
There's 325 people watching Dirty Bomb right now.
It's because they're watching the PC Gamer podcast.
Yeah, right. There's more people watching Super Metroid.
Are you serious?
Yes.